Hello friends, welcome to Gardening with Creekside. I am Jenny and it is an absolutely gorgeous Saturday morning here at the nursery. And we are just gonna take a little bit of time to do a nursery tour and update of what is growing, blooming, and thriving here at the nursery. So we've got our folks out and about working in the nursery, getting everything ready. If you hear a walkie-talkie going off, just ignore it. It's all good. So the whole purpose of these videos is to show you what is, again, growing, blooming, and thriving here at the nursery. Remember, we are in Dallas, North Carolina. It is the middle of May, so this is what is going on with us right now. It's a gorgeous day, beautiful day, a little cool this morning, but I want to show you, we're going to come in here to the greenhouse and show you some of the tropicals that we got last week that are available now. So again, these are tropicals, hence why they're in the greenhouse. Once we have nighttime temperatures that are kind of in that 50 degree or above range, then they're great to come outside. Because they're tropicals, they will be annuals. So unless you bring these indoors throughout the winter, as soon as a freeze gets them, they're gone. So just keep that in mind. To begin with, here we have beautiful and heavy macho ferns. So this is in a, gosh, what is that, a 2 gallon pot, Jerry? Maybe? I don't know, it's a 2 or 3 gallon pot. Obviously, it's a nice big one. Macho ferns are great because they get big, hence the name macho fern. In fact, I just potted one of these up in a large container, excuse me, to go on the back porch. Beautiful, huge green foliage. Obviously, since it's a fern, it is going to need shade. Again, you can overwinter this by bringing it indoors, protect it, and it will go from season to season. Lots of new growth. Yeah, so love these. Again, probably I would recommend putting them in a large container. I suppose you could put them in the ground if you're fine with, you know, losing it in the fall, winter. Also, this was a little bit of a, I wasn't sure how these were going to do when I ordered them. These are red banana trees. Strictly ornamental. They're not going to produce any kind of fruit. These like sold like crazy last weekend. Beautiful green foliage, huge leaves with a deep red veining in them. The new leaves have that burgundy color to them. Again, if you want to put them in a pot, very large pot, you can do that. Or you could put it in the ground. I know these are all really popular with people like around their pool. So these guys are available. Now, if you see a leaf like this, it was damaged in shipping. These came from Florida. You can cut that off because obviously it's just gonna keep producing new leaves throughout the summer. So the red bananas, caladiums are starting to wake up a little bit. Bless them, especially in the other greenhouse, they are waking up. But we also have these mandevillas in a 6-inch pot. So there is red, some of the prettier flowers, red and this gorgeous pink. Now these, of course, are gonna love the sun. They thrive in the heat and the humidity. Just an absolute big, huge burst of color. So if you're looking for a big pop of color in your garden, these would be great. Course, again, you can put them in a container, you could put them in the ground, just massive blooms that they're going to continue to produce all season long. Just gorgeous. Love these. I'm trying to figure out where I can put them at the house. Then we have the trellised mandevilla. This is Alice DuPont, a beautiful pink, and there's just no other way to describe it. The new blooms are more of a deeper, richer pink. The older blooms are a bit of a lighter baby doll pink. They are already on a trellis. So if you're gonna get these, what I would suggest is to leave them on this trellis because trying to unwind it, you might do more damage than you're doing good. So if you have obviously something that is going to climb because they are gonna be very vigorous climbers, you can just plant this next to whatever it is that you want it to climb. So if you already have an established trellis, just put it your trellis right behind it. Before long, you won't even be able to see this wooden one. Again, containers, landscape, Alice DuPont. Now, we have, this is the Hollywood hibiscus series, and they're tropical hibiscus, again, one season long, massive color. I'll just let Jerry just kind of come through here and show you. These oranges are called Playboy, so they all have all these fun names. So this is just that great vibrant orange with that yellow, I guess that's the stamen, a little rusty on my plant terminology there, but gorgeous. Of course, with the hibiscus, their blooms last for a day, so but they're a continuous bloomer. And then over here we have Drama Queen. So Drama Queen, you can see like this bloom, how it's kind of cupped. So this is a new bloom and it is not fully opened yet because the sun hasn't really hit it. So as the sun hits it, it'll open up fully. The ones that are a little wrinkled, those were yesterday's blooms. So Drama Queen is gorgeous. And then, let's see, we didn't have a whole lot of say, well, we didn't have any kind of say over the colors that we were gonna get. This is a fun one. This is Heartbreaker. They don't have a fully opened bloom right now. This one is an old one, but it's a beautiful kind of a sherbet orange with a pure white center. Just gorgeous. This is one of my favorite ones. Really, really pretty. Again, these tropical hibiscus will do great in containers. You can put them in the landscape and they will do wonderfully well. So if you're looking for a big color for a season, we've got your hibiscus and your mandevillas, all sorts of great things. All right, now we're gonna move on over here to outside. Of course, we still have some hanging baskets, full sun hanging baskets. We've got all the super tunias and the foliage plants, the super bells, just tons of beautiful things. Of course, bubblegum is right here. If you remember, bubblegum is probably gonna be your most vigorous petunia on the market. It does extremely well in the landscape, gets nice and tall and spreads. We love bubblegum. It is a great one. The Henryi clematis is blooming. So Henryi is just an industry standard, beautiful, pure white flowers on it. Very extremely long-lived plant. Will give you years and years and years of gorgeous color. They are a one-time bloomer, so a spring bloomer. And they do just beautiful, beautiful things. Let's see, where shall we go? Oh, let's go down here. Coming on down here to the salvias. We've talked about these rockin' salvias so many times before, but we'll just hit them again. Probably the most vigorous one is the rockin' deep purple. Clearly, it's just a beautiful deep purple color. All of the rockin' series salvias, the hummingbirds love. So the deep purple is a great one. There's fuchsia, which is a nice, pretty hot pink. Just beautiful. Camera's not cooperating. Gotta love technology. For those of you who are local, we do have the Buried Treasure strawberries. So this particular one is a beautiful, the pink. So remember their first one was the Buried Treasure red with the red blooms. This year they have introduced pink and white. The berries are the exact same. So it's not a pink strawberry or a white strawberry. It's just that the blooms are different colors. And these are ever-bearing, which means they will give you fruit all season long. So they're a continuous producer of the strawberries. They are a little bit smaller than what you would find at the grocery store, but so delicious, so sweet. We have Amazel Basil. This was actually our second or third round of Amazel Basil. If you're looking for a great all-purpose basil, this is the one to do. It is powdery mildew resistant. It gets ginormous by the end of the season. You will have enough basil to make pesto for the whole year long. Just a great, beautiful, smells like summertime. It is just a fantastic plant. The herbs, of course, are ready and available. So we've got just about every herb that you can imagine over here. The grill is coming along. Yesterday it was looking really great, you know, when the sun hits it. So remember, in the grill, I'm just having fun. I've got the Lakota Fire Echinacea, Yellow Echinacea, Dreamsicle, Bidens, and Red Lantana to go with the fire theme. So we're gonna mosey on over here to the pines because we have a couple of things that I want to show you. First of all, I wanna show you these Indian pinks. This is called Little Redhead. This is a fantastic perennial from Walter's Gardens. There are four of them in here. We got these a couple of years ago, and honestly, I think it was us. It was not the plant. We either got them at the wrong time or we did something. Anyway, they weren't really successful when we grew them. And we saved a couple of them. We had them in one section at the nursery. They did okay. I mean, they were okay. Then this past winter, we dug them up to hold them over because we were going to move them. And then my mama and I just planted them here just a couple of weeks ago. Look at this. This is a fantastic, it is a native plant. So this is Little Redhead, which is also known as Indian Pink. Technically, it is a spigilia. Spigilla? I don't know, y'all. Spigilia. And so this is the Little Redhead. I mean, flaming red blooms. They open up to a beautiful yellow. Major pollinator, hummingbird attractor. What's great is they can do sun to part shade. They are just a fantastic plant. Easy. Clearly, they love being in this space. Right now, we are trialing another Indian pink, Raging Cajun. Raging Cajun is going to be more of an orange tone as opposed to the red tone of Little Redhead, so we will keep you updated on that. We do not currently have any of these available for sale here at the nursery. In fact, I was looking at Walter's, their availability. We will be able to have them next spring. They're just not even available until the year 2022, so we can have these next year. So put this on your list, Little Redhead, if you have an interest in this. They'll get to be about that 12 to 24 inches tall. Now this is a terrible tag because it's very old. Hopefully it'll focus in on that. And it is going to be hardy in zones. I can't read it upside down. Give me a second and I'll tell you. Really cold hardy. Let's see. 5B. Ooh, 5B to 9. There we go. That's what happens when you have older tags. All the dirt and everything starts to get on them. So those are beautiful. Doing great. Our trial section over here for the Eucharas are doing well. Remember, this is evening gown. It's going to be a brand new introduction from Proven Winners and Walter's Gardens. Very similar to Black Pearl, but the leaves on it are just so much larger. Beautiful. It's getting ready to bloom. It's fantastic. Smoke and Mirrors is doing great. I mean, it is handling this space wonderfully. It gets shade until about 2 o'clock, and then it gets the intense afternoon sun for the rest of the day. So right now they're hanging on. And so to give you an idea, this is the evening gown. And then this in the container is Black Pearl. So just to kind of give you kind of a little bit of a slight side-by-side comparison to see the two, you can tell that evening gown just has leaves that are just so much larger. Then, look at this, you ready? This is a massive, massive hosta. This is Proven Winners Empress Wu. Empress Wu is one, if not the largest hosta on the market. It is absolutely huge. Of course, as with all hostas, it does prefer the majority of shade. It can handle some sun. Being a lighter hosta, it can handle some sun. It is going to be 3 to 4 feet tall and basically wide. Your minimum spacing on this is 5 feet. Like, spread them out 5 feet apart. They get huge. This is actually a 3-gallon container, hardy in zones 5 to 9. They give you a tag. So Empress Wu, there you go. So we have these in the 3 gallons. We just have a couple of these in 3 gallons. And then we have a good little bit of number in the 1 gallon size, but when we saw that these were available in a 3 gallon, we had to grab them because obviously it's going to take a little bit of time to for this hosta to get to its mature size. So if it's going to be 3 to 4 feet tall, basically 5 feet wide, you know it's going to take a couple of years to get it there, but that's the fun and the enjoyment of gardening, right? Is to see these plants grow and develop. So we've got those. Look at these. Look at these sweet pennymac hydrangeas. So pennymacs are just a classic southern macrophylla hydrangea. Beautiful. This is what we call a mop head. That beautiful round traditional, what we think of hydrangeas, head on it. These are going to be pH specific as far as their color. So it's either going to be depending on the soil pH that you have. It can be pink or blue, can be a purple. These are a very blush pink, but you can see different ones. Obviously, these are in containers, so their pH is off just a little bit, but you can see in here that we have, like, this was almost a little purpley blush pink. We've got blue, pink, blue, purple. Of course, these will change once they get established into your garden. Now, one that is not based on pH, what we call is color specific, is one of my absolute all-time favorite hydrangeas. This is Zebra. Zebra hydrangea, again, is another macrophylla hydrangea, meaning it's going to do that beautiful mop head on it. But it's called Zebra because the stems are pretty much black and then it has white blooms on it. These are fantastic, both the Zebra and the pennymac. They can handle filtered sun or morning sun, but they can't handle, they're not an all-day sun kind of hydrangea. Those are going to be like your paniculas, panicles. These guys prefer those shady conditions. I have one of these in our shade garden at the house. It is doing just as well as this, but like, look, this is practically a full-grown hydrangea right here, because zebras will get to be 4 feet tall, 3 feet wide. So it's not quite full grown, but it's it's got a good start on it. And they are hardy in zones five to, it doesn't tell me. But of course we're a 7B and it works great. I would think probably like an 8 or a 9. So cold hardy, can handle the heat. Gorgeous. So if you've got a shady area that you're looking to, you need a little bit of height in, then this would be a great one to add to your collection. Come over here, peonies. We got peonies last week. Peonies, I say peonies. They are pretty much done with their blooms for this year. All of these, when they were arrived to us, I guess it was last week that they came, oh my heavens, they smelled amazing. I mean, just, oh, that rich peony smell. Basically, they're all going to be in the white pink family. Of course, they all have tags. You can look them up. But just know that we've got beautiful 3 gallon peonies available for purchase here at the nursery. And let's see, what else? I do want to talk about, come over here for a second. I do want to talk about these fantastic ferns. Also got these in. Right now, it's really hard for us to find ferns. Their availability is limited on these guys. This is a ghost fern. I have ghost ferns over in our shade garden. I love this plant. It is going to be a tall fern. These are perennials, obviously, shade loving. Again, can handle some morning sun. Can't handle that hot, intense sun. But basically, it's a combination of a lady fern. Lady ferns are tall and upright, and a Japanese painted fern. Japanese painted ferns are low, but they have beautiful color to them, that silvery color. So this is a great combination of both of them. You get the height of a lady fern, but that beautiful silvery color. The veins are almost, and the stems have a reddish hue to them. These are wonderful mixed in with your hostas and your shade-loving hydrangeas and all sorts of things. So for your shade garden, again, you can do this in a container or you can do it in the ground. Love this. What will happen to it at the end of the season? A freeze comes, it'll zap all the foliage. You just cut it all the way back down to the ground. Leave it, early spring, it emerges and comes back. One of the easiest low maintenance plants for the shade garden. Love that. And those ferns are that way. This is a fun one. I don't have a tag in front of me. This is Banana Boat. We're continuing with our shade gardens here. Banana Boat is a perennial grass for the shade. These do that bright, beautiful pop of color, bring some brightness. This would definitely come and put at the front of your garden bed because it is going to be low, low and wide. Banana Boat, this is one that we got from Walters. I saw a picture of it and I was like, this is a great plant. The tags are somewhere. We'll have to find the tags. Trying to keep up with tags and plants can be challenging. Jerry, here's the phlox. We were looking for phlox yesterday, all over the place, couldn't find it. It's right there. The struggle is real. I want to give you a little bit of an update on this refrigerator and the drinking gourd, because oh my word, y'all. So she's doing great. You can tell she's massive. You can see I put some, these are ghost ferns that I put here. So here is a Japanese painted fern peeking out from under there, doing well. My poor lady in red fern back there. Yeah. But the drinking gourd is getting ready to bloom. Huge, massive, cupped leaves. They'll hold on to it. The astilbe back here in the corner is getting ready to bloom as well. She's actually holding her own. She's doing pretty good against the old drinking gourd. So she has got her blooms. They're coming up, getting ready to pop open with some color. I've got my annuals in here. This is the Endless Illumination Broalia with some coral reef, Rockapuco coral reef. The Double Impatience. Don't be afraid to pinch back your impatience. If they get too tall and leggy, when I planted these were a little, they were a little leggy. They had a little length to them. They were a little long, too top heavy. I just snipped them back and they are nice now and compact and they're covered in buds. You could do the same thing with the Broalia. If it starts to get a little out of control, you can always give it a little prune back. Let's see, what else? Oh, I'm gonna show you one more thing and then we'll sign off for today. We do have some beautiful moor hydrangeas. This is the Twist and Shout. It's gonna be a lace cap. So this is a great example. Jerry, can we zoom in on that? We talked about mop heads. This is a lace cap. Lace caps are just a completely different bloom on a hydrangea. I love having a mix of these hydrangeas in my garden, whether it's a panicle, you know, a lace cap or a mop head. It just brings different color and texture to the garden. So this is Twist and Shout. It is going to be 3 to 5 feet tall, 3 to 4 feet wide, and it's going to be hardy in zones 4 to 9. Extremely versatile. What I came over here to show you was the Sun King. I did a social media post earlier this week of my shade garden and the Sun Kings in our garden. Maybe if you flip around this way. These are just a beautiful foliage plant. Fantastic for the shade garden. They will bloom at the end of the summer, but their bloom is really insignificant. It truly is all about the color and the shape and the size. These will easily get 4 feet tall, 4 feet wide. I had one person on social media say that she had had hers for several years. Hers was already 5 feet tall, 5 feet wide. So if they're in a spot that they love, they will get huge. But just imagine, you know, that in your shade garden, that massive pop of color, nice height to your garden, because sometimes that can be hard to find for a shade garden, that bright color with the height and the form. So Sun King does that. It is extremely easy. Again, the bugs don't really like it. I don't have to treat it. Mine gets some morning sun and then it's in the shade for the rest of the day. Beautiful, easy, low maintenance plants. I think you would love them if you have a shady spot in your garden. But I think, oh, one more thing. I always do this, right? I'm like, oh, we're almost done. Let me just show you. Yeah, well, one more. Okay. So this is a fantastic hosta. I promise this is my last thing for today. Hosta. So last year we got these, and sometimes getting tags with plants can be everything in the horticultural world right now is under stress. So we didn't get the tags when we got the rootstock. So we planted these up, put them in these black containers, and just kind of stuck them off to the side. Well, when we got the tags, we didn't go ahead and immediately put them in the pots. Winter comes, and we're like, what is in that, you know, what are in these containers? We had no clue. Like, well, we'll just wait and see if something comes up. So a couple of weeks ago, they started to emerge, and I was like, this is the praying hands. This is praying hands hosta. It is going to be very upright. It is going to keep those really wavy lines. They're like cupped hands that are praying, hence the name praying hands hosta. It's going to be petite. It's not going to be a huge, massive height. It keeps this dark, dark green color, extremely, again, upright, heavily curled and cupped. It is a really unique, exquisite hosta. Even folks who have been collecting hostas for years, this might be new to you. So we have some of the praying hands hostas here at the nursery available for you to purchase. We will get those tags and stick them in there. But I think that's it. We just had our first customer arrive for the day. So we have got to get off of here and help the sweet folks who are coming to see us. As always, thank you so much for gardening with Creekside. We'll see you in the next video. Bye, friends.